My name is Clay Purvis. I am the Director for Telecommunications and Connectivity for the Department of Public Service. And I'm here to testify today on S-289, draft number 6. So I think I'll begin my comments by just, you know, noting the evolution of this bill and its cousin, H-680. It includes now a waiver, which is very similar to the executive order that the administration issued on February 18th, in mid-February of 2018. The executive order proscribes state agencies from purchasing internet access services for state agencies from companies that do not support net neutrality principles, blocking, throttling, and paid prioritization. The executive order does allow, in very limited circumstances, for the Secretary of Administration to grant a waiver. This bill appears to do something very similar. It has the same general concept in mind. It does add additional requirements to the net neutrality scheme or system of regulation in Vermont. I'm going to call your attention to section 10. Amends Title IX, which is the Consumer Protection Code, and it requires internet service providers to make a disclosure as to their practices, whether or not they comply with the net neutrality standards that are defined in Title III. And then it goes on to say the disclosure shall be made in the form and manner prescribed by the Commissioner of Public Service, and the commissioner shall post the disclosures required by this section on a publicly available, easily accessible website maintained by the agency. The scheme that the Restoring Internet Freedom Order created transitioned net neutrality regulation from the FCC, where it was held under the Open Internet Order, to the FTC. And in that order, the FCC stated that traditional roles of consumer protection were not preempted, but that utility-style regulation of net neutrality is preempted. And this section, to me, I guess would give me concern about our ability to withstand a challenge of a preemption, given that the Department of Public Service is the state's utility regulator. We represent the public interest in front of the Public Utility Commission, and this kind of disclosure put in our shop, we would be the ones then to make decisions about the legitimacy of that disclosure and whether they've met the standards that are in Title III and in this Title IX. So I wanted to point that out as a potential issue for the committee to think about as it's crafting its legislation.
Okay. So there's nothing in there about regulation. It just says that they're going to disclose, and you're going to post it on a website. there's nothing in there that says you have to enforce it. There's nothing in there that says you have to do anything with it other than post it on a website.
That is true, but you have an agency whose mandate comes under Title 30, enforcing a compliance that I believe is in Title 9. Our concern is that the more it looks like utility-style regulation, the more likely it is to face a preemption challenge. And traditional rules consumer protection, especially those falling under Title IX, you know, historically have been enforced by the Attorney General's office. So it is somewhat of an interesting choice to pick the Commissioner of Public Service to do this, you know, because we do regulate these very same companies, but we regulate very different services. We regulate telephone, we regulate, when it comes to these companies, we regulate their telecommunication services, whether that's voice over IP or telephone service. So, in my mind, you're enhancing the argument that this is a utility-style regulation of this service, even though the enforcement measure is under Title IX.
Robin?
And that was my point in the Section B, there, a violation of this section. It's an Unfair and Deceptive Act in Trade and Commerce, which is enforced by the Attorney General. So it essentially, to me, says that in the statute, right in that spot, saying you post the list, but enforcement is the Attorney General.
Correct. But it may be cleaner if it's just all under the Attorney General. The Attorney General posts the disclosures. Companies would make the disclosure with the Attorney General, and the Attorney General enforces it. If really all we're doing is maintaining a website of disclosures on net neutrality, consumers are more likely, if we're doing it under Title IX, consumers are more likely to know to go to the Attorney General's office for complaints regarding deceptive business practices, other industries, for instance, that are regulated under Title IX.
Mike?
Well, I was just thinking that if somebody's dealing with a telecommunication company, they might be more likely to go to a public utility, public service board website than the Attorney General's website. But I don't see this as really jeopardizing the non-regulatory aspect of the FCC's decision. But that's my opinion, I guess.
Well, you're putting this disclosure with the public utility regulator. And so regardless of whether we're actually regulating anything, you know, the more it looks like utility regulation, the more likely there's going to be a challenge, and that those challenging the order will prevail on that order or on that challenge.
Mark?
Can I ask Maria a question?
Yep.
Are you aware of another regulatory entity in state government, although this is your specialty, but that requires disclosures? Where are you, Clay?
I'm probably speaking at a turn here, but the finance industry often has to make certain disclosures, but I can't think of a situation, of course, I don't know everything, but I can't think of a situation where one agency is responsible for maintaining and housing that disclosure and other agencies charged with enforcing violations of that disclosure.
Are you talking more specifically about disclosures on a publicly available website for consumers,
mm-hmm.
or disclosures for oversight of
Well, I'm just thinking about
activities.
This, you know, argument that Clay is making where they're the regulators and we're proposing that they also be the place where public disclosure is made, even though they're not the ones that be enforcing that. But the Attorney General enforces all of our laws.
We enforce the laws in Title 30. The Attorney General often represents the state in appeals to the Vermont Supreme Court or to federal court PUC decisions. When it comes to Title IX, they do enforce everything under Title IX.
Robin had a question. Mark.
You were stating that putting this in here could make it more likely that we would face a legal challenge. And my understanding is that we face a legal challenge by virtue of acting in any way.
Yes.
So this wouldn't increase the likelihood of a legal challenge. It's confusing because it looks like we're regulating when we're It looks like we're asking you to regulate when we're really just asking you to host a website. Is that
my understanding of the Restoring Internet Freedom Order, at least the preemption language in that order, traditional roles of consumer protection are not preempted. Utility-style regulation is preempted. So to the extent that your law walks and talks like utility regulation, it is preempted to the extent that it looks like traditional role of the Attorney General and the Attorney General's office in its traditional role as enforcer of consumer protection laws under Title IX, that is not preempted.
I guess I would ask that the public ISPs, telecommunication providers, generally interact with the Department of Public Service and Public Utility Commission, but not necessarily with the Attorney General. So why give them an extra level of interaction that they have to go through with state government?
Because if this is a system that the legislature decides to move forward with, such a move would fall more under the Attorney General's traditional role as consumer protection. As utility regulators, part of our job in regulating utilities, for instance, is the collection of information. We collect all kinds of information, regardless of whether we can act on that information. We collect annual reports from companies every year that ask questions like how many lines in service, how many homes do you pass, financial data that maybe we don't necessarily have the ability to do anything with other than it informs public policy, it does that kind of thing. And that is a traditional role of public utility regulation, in fact. Many public utility commissions started out. We regulated the railroads. Before we regulated them, we set up very toothless railroad commissions whose job is really to collect information. And it's actually how they built the case that the railroad industry was incredibly unsafe and dangerous and needed to be regulated. So that is a, the mere collection of information is a utility style function. It's a public utility type of regulation. So, I mean, I think that's the argument against this particular scheme.
So, I'll ask the question to anybody who might know the answer. Does the Attorney General's office publish lists of anything that, you know, like similar to such disclosures? If anything, I was thinking maybe a Secretary of State's agency that would publish something like that, but
I'm sure the Secretary of State does. I'm not aware of anything, but that doesn't mean they don't.
Because the Attorney General's office is generally concerned with litigation.
Yep.
Not necessarily with advertising what kind of compliance standards have to be adhered to.
Do you post any other disclosures on your website?
Do we post any other disclosures on our website? Not that I'm aware of. I'll look into that. There may be something in electricity or gas that I'm not aware of, but I've never seen a particular kind of disclosure on our website. But I don't know the answer to that. I'll look into that and get back to you on that.
It seems so. Disclosures. I mean, that's one question. But you do post information about cell service coverage, and I mean, you have maps and all of that. But yet, you can't regulate them.
Correct.
Under federal law, but you're posting information about them. And so how is this different than that, if you're posting information about something that you can't regulate?
It's not. I think it's very similar. We post all kinds of information on public services such as cell and broadband, despite the fact that we can't regulate them. We're not preempted from doing that. Arguably here, we may be preempted from doing that. So to the extent that this looks like utility regulation and collecting and providing data and making policy choices based on that data is all something that has been a traditional role of public utility commissions since before electricity. So, in fact, I believe one of the first legislative reports that was ever mandated by our department was an almanac of railroad information, going back prior to 1900. So that is absolutely a traditional role of public utility regulation. I have other concerns with the bill. I'm happy to go over those as well. Section regarding the Universal Service Fund. Maria, I'm so sorry. What page is that on?
19. Did 19,
okay.
Disclosure,
but I'll
talk
about that later.
Do you want to scroll down there?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Connectivity. Not 19, but the section that limits funding in 7511. I think this is on page 14. I just want to draw the committee's attention to section on the connectivity funding. Notwithstanding any other provision of law to the contrary, funds to support broadband internet access service as defined in 3 VSA 348 in whole or part shall be awarded under this chapter only to internet service providers who have obtained a certificate of net neutrality compliance under 3 VSA. This shall apply to all awards made on or after July 1st. I think the department's concern here is the relative benefit to doing this. As you know, we have limited funds in the connectivity fund. The high cost fund is equally limited. This could cause companies who would otherwise take funding to bring broadband and they may decide not to do it as a result of that, of this section, that they cannot or as a company policy will not comply with the net neutrality definition in Title III. And to us, that's concerning for two reasons. First, broadband is a service that we know people in the state very much want. And much of the challenge of bringing broadband to rural Vermont has to do with the cost. The cost of providing, of building that service, and the cost of maintaining that service. And in many states, public money is being put forward to develop rural broadband. So Massachusetts, New York, Washington State, Tennessee, Virginia, and the states, you know, all over the country are doing this. There's a recognition that that rural broadband is important. If we limit the number of companies who can participate in these programs, our concern is that we will limit the effectiveness of the connectivity initiative. Fund. But it's a policy decision that your committee is should make, and just wanted to point out to you that this may have an adverse impact on our ability to choose between various technologies, for instance, cable over DSL. Fiber or DSL in some areas.
Could you repeat that? You said, for instance, I didn't get that.
For instance, I'm sorry, cable over fiber or fiber, excuse me, cable over DSL or fiber over DSL. In areas where it may be possible to extend multiple different services, and we're choosing between very similar proposals, but with different technology.
Laura, and then Robin.
So I hear this argument, I hear the logic in this argument. If there was any serious investment that was happening, this would make some sense to me. I'm not sure what the difference would look like between now and if we did this. You know, we're almost at none now. We're almost at none now. So, again, I'm hearing the argument. The argument is making some sense to me, but I think we do need to keep everything kind of on a real level also, which is the negative consequences that are possible with the almost non-existent funds that we give you every year to invest, you know, are hard to take super seriously. So, no comment needed.
No, I think I will comment on that. I understand the frustration of this committee and the legislature wants to see rural broadband expanded, and you know, personally, I can't argue with that as my job as the director for telecommunications. We are advocating for the expansion of these services. However, the places where we don't have broadband today, where we need broadband, are, from the perspective of a telecom provider, the worst of the worst. They happen to be some of the most beautiful places in the state of Vermont, but they are.
Suck up tonight.
But from a business case standpoint,
they're on Lake Champlain.
They are the most challenging.
I thought we had good ones.
I was referencing the Northeast Kingdom, but. from a business case standpoint, they are the most challenging. And even if you give money to build broadband in a lot of these areas, the question becomes, can we support the ongoing operations? And in some cases, you know, not to pick on the cable industry, but the cable industry is built out where they want to be in the state. And so encouraging cable development, which is frankly a very good service, to expand. It provides you our state goal of 100-100, cable can do it, right? 100 megs down, 100 megs up, cable can do it. Cable comes with TV, cable comes with telephone. The cable industry by and large provides you the service that you pay for, which is not always true with other forms of broadband, such as satellite and some DSL companies, according to FCC research, DSL companies are less likely to provide you the service that you're paying for. Cable companies usually do. And so this is a type of service that we want to see expanded. So, go ahead.
Yeah, but Would you like to finish? Yeah, why don't we let you finish it?
To the extent that we can do what we can to encourage cable development, I think that's a positive step.
So I just want to kind of generally say, you know, there's definitely an ominous air of if you do X or Y or Z, there's going to be a negative consequence. So I think we need to establish that, first of all, where it's pretty hard the situation to get worse than it is now. That we've already kind of touched on. Second of all, any place that I have seen expansion, it's been, you know, and there's a number of providers that have done it who are to be lauded for, you know, working with the department. So I don't want to get in your way or in their way to be able to work nimbly. I understand that. But, you know, this, I feel like we've got this, you know, if you do nothing, then you're going to be fine. I don't think so, because actually what's coming to me is we're already not fine because of the governor's executive order. So I kind of like, and I'm sorry, this is all coming at you, but it's not at you. It's around us all.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, I kind of like to get away from that. You know, we're talking about what's going to incent or disincent good behavior. You know, more of the things that we want. You know, I don't love this section anyway, but, you know, the whole notion of, you know, if we do this, maybe, they, you know, good things will happen. Good things aren't happening now. You know, so, I mean, there's some good things that are happening right now. Yes, excuse me, you know, and, but, you know, anyway, I'd like to just kind of move
to that. Did you want to respond to that, or you? As Laura said before, you don't have
it's,
to.
And it's not necessarily just directed at you. It's just in general, you know, there's a sense of, you know, like, you know, if you do anything, it's, you know, stuff's going to get really bad. What does really bad look like?
I'm not saying that this is going to make things really bad. Well, all I'm saying is that it'll diminish the number of companies that are willing to participate in the connectivity mission.
Yes, I understand. And I think that no matter what we do with this bill right here, I think we already have providers that have probably made decisions based on the governor's executive order. So even if we take that out, I think we already have a problem with providers.
Well, arguably the executive order, which applies to government contracts, would apply to the connectivity initiative anyway. So if you want a connectivity initiative grant, maybe not. I don't know. That's a, the difference between a contract and a grant agreement, state government, is a thing that I didn't initially appreciate. But
I'd like to pull this section out. I'll just say that.
So. You'd like to pull this section out?
Yeah.
Robin?
I have a couple of questions. One is, we did hear testimony on whether a grant is the same as a contract for service, and we're assured that they are different.
Okay.
My first question is the intent of this language that and the words that were highlighted awarded
mm-hmm.
was to make a distinction between grants that have been already awarded but the money has not been disbursed yet.
Yes.
Versus new grants.
Yes.
And that this would apply only to new grants. Subsequently, not to.
Yes, that's not
clear. Okay, and does this? Are you happy with the wording that it accomplishes that?
I am satisfied that the language accomplishes your intent, the committee's intent to only have this section apply to grants that are awarded after July 1st. So. If we issue an RFP in June and award grants, just as a purely hypothetical, in August, that we would review the awards for compliance with that valid. So that is made clear to me in this language. I'm raising general policy considerations. High costs supports rural telephone companies. Companies that, frankly, lost support from the federal government through the redistribution of funds in the CAF program. And I imagine you've heard from the independent telephone companies on that issue earlier in the session. But this high cost program we have in the state is in some ways to make up for that. It hardly does, but that is the intent of that program. So, you know, companies are, to the extent they're required to make disclosure under federal law, they're making those disclosures already. This adds a new layer of regulation and is further complicating their, frankly, small telephone companies' ability to continue providing service in some of the state's most rural areas.
I'm sorry, how does it? They have to state their business practices.
Right.
How does that complicate them doing
business? Well, this is more than stating their, my understanding is that they have to, maybe I'm misreading this, that they're obtaining money through the VUSF. They have to be net neutrality compliant. So not merely stating their business practice, but actually complying with the prohibition on blocking, throttling, and state prioritization.
So state their business practice, and if their business practice is to not participate in blocking, throttling, or paid prioritization, then they are certified.
It's the certification under Title III, not the one under Title IX. So there's two certifications in the bill. So there's this one in Section 348, which I think is the one that's being referenced here, 348D1. It starts on page 7. So subsection A of 340 says the Secretary of Administration shall develop a process by which internet service provider may certify that it is in compliance with consumer protection and net neutrality standards established in subsection B of this section. So then the Secretary of Administration would provide a certificate that they are in compliance. And then subsection D of this section, I think it's on the following page, is that page 9 actually, defines Maria, am I right on this? I apologize.
I think so. There's the certification process that the Secretary of Administration establishes, and it's to certify compliance with essentially 5 net neutrality rules, no blocking, etc. That certification is necessary under this bill for a state contract for internet service or for an award under the Universal Service Fund. Then there's a disclosure requirement in section, I think it's 10 of this bill, about whether or not you engage in net neutrality practices. So you don't need to get certified for that. You don't have to get certified. You just have to make a disclosure about your practices, whether they would comply with the net neutrality rules or not. And that's just a disclosure. And that's on a publicly available website, whether it's the AG's or the department's. Does that make sense?
Is that not part of the compliance, that disclosure? That isn't that what the compliance certificate is based on, that disclosure?
There's a disclosure, and maybe, as that was claimed, but as part of the net neutrality rules, the federal rules that were incorporated in your bill, your certificate of compliance, you're required to make a disclosure to consumers about your network management practices, right? So you are prohibited from certain conduct,
mm-hmm.
and then there's a required disclosure that you need to make to the consumers. That's all part of net neutrality in general, as it's been defined under the 2015 order, right? You abide by those, you know, the rules, and you make the disclosure, the transparency.
But the certificate of compliance is based on making the disclosure that you are compliant.
Making the disclosure of what your network management practices are in
that
general.
That have to be compliant.
In order to take monies under the USF or to get a state contract, that you have to be, as a ISP, you have to certify to the Secretary of Administration that you're not blocking, you're not throttling, and you're not engaging in paid prioritization practices, other than the network management, reasonable network management practices that are allowed. So it's very separate from the mandatory disclosure, because you don't have to be net neutrality compliant under the Title IX disclosure.
Okay, so the way I'm reading this bill is, yeah, you can disclose anything. You can disclose that you're not net neutral compliant, that you're not abiding by that net neutrality stuff. That doesn't get you a certificate of compliance.
Correct.
The Secretary can only issue a certificate of compliance if you would say that you are abiding by the provisions of net neutrality, right?
It's a little bit different of a disclosure requirement. So if you think of it this way, think of 5 rules under the 2015 order, the net neutrality rules, the so-called net neutrality rules under the Open Internet Order. This is what all companies have to comply with now for as long as the rules are in effect, April 23rd, I think. You can't block, You can't throttle. You can't engage in paid
prioritization. You can't. What was the first thing you said, Maria?
You can't. No blocking. No throttling. No paid prioritization. No unreasonable interference. And disclosure of your network management practices. That's not that you're net neutral. That's what are your practices? How do? What are the speeds that you provide? What are the charges for the speeds and the service? This is all to inform the consumer of what your practices are. You already can't block, you can't throttle, you can't do paid prioritization. That's required under the existing 2015 order. But there's an additional requirement that you keep your consumers, your subscribers, informed of all of your practices. What's a reasonable network management practices? What are your, you know, what are the speeds of your service and how much are you charging? That's just a disclosure that you need to make as part of being consistent.
As part of getting the certification by the secretary, right?
And just like under the 2015 order, this proposed bill has the same requirements to get certified that you're in compliant with net neutrality standards.
Right.
You don't engage in certain practices, you make the requisite disclosure to your consumers about general practices. So, and the only companies that need to get certified under this proposal are companies that want state contracts or they want state dollars in the form of a grant. So keep those separate. Then there's an additional requirement, just in general, your provider, an ISP doing business in the state of Vermont, you need to let a department know, in general, whether you comply with the net neutrality standards or not. You're not required to do one or the other. You just have to make that disclosure so that people can go to a website, look at the various companies, make a determination maybe about who they want to do business with, what the options are. Does that make
sense? Yes. But with regard to this, these USF funds, they require a certificate of compliance with net neutrality standards in order to
state dollars under the Vermont Universal Service Fund. To get an award, state dollars, you have to certify compliance with net neutrality, just like you do to get a state contract for internet service.
Right.
Those companies, yes.
So if we take this out.
If you take which out?
The section about USF funds.
Then you no longer need to be correct.
And basically, we've removed the last baby tooth we've got in this thing, because we have the waiver in there. We've already removed most of the teeth. Got one little baby tooth left, and that's this.
But the question that I asked originally was that how is this a burden? You said this would be a burden, potential burden on some small providers.
To the extent that they can't or it's not in their business to be compliant with net neutrality as defined here, the value of a high cost fund, you know, is tied to broadband. But it's also tied to telephone service. These are traditional telephone companies providing traditional telephone service in areas where, frankly, they have a history of being subsidized because the business model is so challenging in these areas. And this fund isn't very important for that continued support. So to the extent that we're going to have, you know, another criteria that they have to be net neutral, and I'm sure many, I don't want to speak for the telephone companies, but I think some of them will certify, some won't. You may be eliminating a valuable funding source for companies that either can't or not in their best interest to be compliant under Title III.
Do you expect that some ISPs or phone companies will not seek certification, or will not proclaim neutrality?
I wouldn't put it out of the realm of possibility. I think it's very likely that some companies will choose not to certify for whatever reason.
I think in terms of public public support, that's
right.
Their selling point. That's what they, you know, that's what they would want to proclaim.
You may want to talk to the independent phone companies about this this particular provision and see what their, I don't want to speak for their group on this issue, but you know, as far as the connectivity initiative goes, you know, many of the companies who could actually extend the best service in our state, you know, may choose, you know, they're setting national policies about net neutrality. They may choose not to participate in a small grant program in Vermont. It may not be that valuable to a large national company, but it is incredibly valuable to us as a state to have that service expanded. So. I'm not sure if how much of an incentive this is going to be for, on the grant side, for companies to participate in that program. For,
can I make one more comment?
And then Mike.
So in terms of broadband, getting away from the ILECs, I would think that if a company doesn't, for whatever reason, chooses that it's not in their interest to be net neutral, then I think that gives incentive to the Union Telecommunications Districts or the EC Fiber model to build networks that are. I would much rather see our money go to support those than a company that is not net neutral. Comment, not.
Yeah, and I just think the rebuttal to that, and of course we've granted money to EC Fiber, which I think you're probably the second largest grantee that we have, and EC Fiber is a great model. It's in 27 towns, 24, thank you.
A bunch.
A bunch, but not in all 270. Towns that we have, of course, and that's an estimate. I don't know how many towns we have, but there are a lot of places in the state where the obvious choice is a cable company or a telephone company, and the question is whether, with this additional restriction on the funds, will it still be enough of an incentive to take the grant funding and build the broadband. Frankly, they're not obligated to build. So I think that's the question and the concern that I have for this particular provision.
Mike.
So I was just, Robin stated pretty much what I was going to state, but I would say that the smaller providers are probably the least likely to not be net neutral.
Yeah, that might be the case, but you never know.
Don't know whether they would have an incentive to throttle or walk or whatever.
So I imagine even for the large companies, it comes down to what reasonable network management is. It's about managing your network. So, just in conclusion, you know, I would say three things about this bill. One, it does model the executive order, which we already have in effect. So it does many of the same things that we do already. And then it adds the connectivity portion, which we have concerns about. And then in the last section, the automatic disclosure that looks a lot like public utility style regulation, and raises concerns about preemption.
So then you don't support it right now?
Correct.
Okay, thank you, Clay.
All right, thank you very much.
I have one more.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So just to make sure that I'm clear, and I don't know if this is for you, and I see Secretary Quinn is here also, with regards to the underlying bill here and the executive order, I just want to ensure that what would be the consequences of, wait a minute, we drafted, so our whole, I'm trying to catch up to where I was, not whole, our waiver piece that we had in here is different than the waiver piece that's in the executive order, yes. So that was my question. So what is the difference between the two waiver pieces? So the governor's executive order waiver and then the waiver that's in the Senate.
Sorry, I believe there was no waiver in the Senate.
It was, yeah.
Correct.
Okay.
Senator Brock, though, had a proposed
yes. Senator Brock, excuse me. Okay,
yes.
Is the Brock language in this draft?
Thank you.
It is.
I can't interpret my own.
Okay.
Yeah.
It is, yep. We haven't reviewed it, but it's in the latest draft based on last week's conversation.
What page is that? Is it the highlighted intent here, or the waiver? Okay. I do know the executive order up. Read.
Yeah, it's a highlighted whole page.
Yeah, a section starting at section B.
There you go.
Yep.
Is it still 4141?
Yes. And another.
Yeah. And we're on page 11. That captures almost everything. The executive order says waivers to these procedures may be granted by the secretary only upon receipt of a written justification from a state agency and a finding by the secretary that a waiver would serve a legitimate and significant interest of the state. The Department of Public Service shall resolve any disputes over the definition of terminology used in the executive order. This waiver says, notwithstanding the certification requirement in A, the secretary may waive such a requirement if he or she determines that a waiver is the sole option available to mitigate an imminent threat to the continuity of critical government operations, that the waiver is in the best interest of the state, and that the waiver is first approved by the emergency board. So this waiver provides additional requirements from the Secretary of Administration's role under the executive order.
So Senator Brock's is more expansive than?
Well, more restrictive of the Secretary's ability to grant a waiver. And then you have this intent language underneath in C.
Was that considered by the administration for the executive order? I'm just wondering if there was a choice made to go to this.
I would look to Secretary Quinn for the administration's position on that particular waiver. I actually don't remember.
May I?
Yes.
Yes.
So with regards, let me see. And
John, at some point, identify yourself.
For the record, John Quinn, Secretary of Digital Services.
So,
yes, you're next.
So with regard to Senator Brock's amendment that he had proposed that was then defeated, and then we had the executive order, which looks similar, and we've gone back and put in, we're trying to figure out how to incorporate, you know, what the differences are here, what the pieces are. So.
Is there something wrong with what the executive order outlines for a waiver process?
So, I think we felt that it was too expansive. And so what we wanted to understand is what the concern is of the administration and making sure that it was a little wider than what Senator Brock, and maybe you didn't consider Senator Brock's, but if you did.
Right. I don't recall
okay.
Whether we talked specifically about Senator Brock's language
okay.
that he had.
Okay.
Great.
I think as far as C goes, you know, the Secretary of Administration would only grant the waiver if all other means of obtaining that service fail. So.
This one, I mean, there needs to be more cause, not just like, well, we're just going to grant a waiver. And so you get, it sounds like we have no position on that. You all haven't had a chance to review that piece in there.
We'll take a look.
Is this the first you guys have seen this language?
No, we saw it.
Yep.
Yeah, it's been in the bill since, I think, Friday.
Yep.
So, yeah.
And I think it's word for word, Maria, right? Word for word, the same as the limit that Senator Brock offered on the side of the
different version.
11.
That failed at 6.
It was the draft that came out on Friday, 12-12. So there's like a earlier in the morning draft that's a little different.
Right.
If there are no other questions for me, thank you very much.
Well, I guess I just like to ask that at some point, if you could tell us how you feel about this language. What is there, will there be a position on it from the administration?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, Corey.
You're
welcome.
Thank you.
So we've had Maria in this discussion somewhat. Does the committee want to have the walkthrough? Or?
There was one more question we had for Maria, too.
So why don't we have Maria come up? And John, did you want to testify there? Because you were on the list.
That's right. So I don't need to. Clay did a good job of the administration's position. But I do have to go testify downstairs. So if you have any questions for me, now's the time, or I can come back later.
That was it for me.
Okay.
Does anybody have any questions for the secretary, that the commissioner wasn't able to answer, or his answer wasn't adequate? I guess not.
Okay.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So can I just ask my question first? Maria?
Oh, Maria?
Yes.
Well, yeah,
before
okay.
she does the walkthrough. So with regard to lawsuit dollars and precedents, I think we had talked about that.
Yes. Maria Royal with Legislative Council. You had asked last Friday if there were other examples where the General Assembly was concerned about litigation regarding a specific act and if they ever set aside any money. I got two.
The GMO discussion.
Two examples, yes. The GMO labeling. Law did, as part of that act, establish a genetically engineered food labeling special fund. And that fund was to pay the costs or liabilities incurred by the Attorney General or the state in implementation and administration of the program.
What program was that?
Of the labeling program.
Mm-hmm.
So any litigation from
GMO
labeling. And in terms of the amount of money in the fund, it could accept private gifts, bequests, grants, etc. Then except for those recoveries that by law are appropriated for other uses, up to $1.5 million of settlement monies collected by the Office of the Attorney General, that as determined by the AG after consultation with the Joint Fiscal Office, exceed the estimated amounts of settlement proceeds in July of 2014. I think that's pretty much the nutshell of that. And then the only other one that somebody mentioned to me, there was back in 2013 some anticipated litigation with respect to grandless appeals involving TransCanada hydroelectric property, and some money was set aside to help municipalities that were going to be engaged, and the amount there was set aside $50,000, which was transferred to the Attorney General and then could be dispersed to the municipalities.
Okay. Okay, Maria, if you could just take us through your highlighted
sure.
parts in each of the
yes.
And anybody have any questions about other language, go ahead. But
yep.
In the meantime, let's just look at the changes from this latest draft.
I'd be happy to do that. Yes. For the record, Maria Royal with Legislative Council. Sorry for not saying that sooner.
You did, right?
Did I? I can't. Yeah. Honestly, God, I can't keep track of anything these days. So. I think you kind of went through the first one, which is the waiver provision with respect to state contracts, and that is identical to Senator Brock's language. So it's pretty restrictive about what constitutes waiver consistent with this provision. Do you want to go through it in detail again?
I have a couple of just political questions about it. Do you know what the vote was? Was there a roll call? Was it a voice vote? And do you recall what the reason did the committee oppose it?
As a whole, I don't know. I mean, Senator Brock is on the finance committee, so obviously
yep.
he did not oppose it. As far as the other members, I don't know how they voted.
I'll talk to him.
We may have an answer coming up.
Okay, well, in the meantime, let's
okay. And so do you want to go through this language in detail?
Well, we had a good discussion about the other day. Is anybody... Laura?
This section. I wouldn't mind a run through it, and then I have a
yep.
number of
okay.
questions.
Sure. Okay. So as you can see, this pertains to state contracts. This is a provision that requires the Secretary of Administration to amend the Procurement Bulletin 3.5, requiring that all ISPs comply with net neutrality, get that certification. So then subsection B, notwithstanding the certification requirement in subsection A, the Secretary may waive such requirement if he or she determines that a waiver is the sole option available to mitigate an imminent threat to the continuity of critical government operations, that the waiver is in the best interest of the state, and that the waiver is first approved by the Emergency Board. And then a statement of intent. It is the intent of the General Assembly that the Secretary will not seek a waiver under subsection B until after he or she has made all reasonable efforts to enter into a contract consistent with the terms and conditions specified in subsection A, and has determined that without a waiver, critical functions of government will be at risk. And then I don't think we've really talked about the publication section last week. And so you may want to consider it here in this context. The Secretary shall disclose on a publicly available website the names of all ISPs awarded government contracts under this section and whether the provider is in compliance with the Consumer Protection and Net Neutrality Standards. If a provider is granted a waiver under subsection B, the Secretary shall provide the reasons for granting the waiver.
So, now we've got two websites. Two different websites.
Yeah.
We have to get that.
Conceivably, you could do both. You could combine them. I think that's a policy choice.
I would say let's. If we're doing either or both, let's try and actually not make a behemoth.
And make it what,
instead, a behemoth.
Yeah. Right. Instead of giving it to the Department of Public Service, put it all on the Secretary of Administration.
Yeah.
Who would look there?
We could see what.
Okay.
Maybe the administration.
How about Agency of Digital Services?
It's not there. I mean, it's really the AG or DPS.
Right.
You had asked about other disclosures,
yeah.
And so I just sitting over there, I just quickly tried to find some other examples. I did find three. There's a law that requires drug companies to disclose gifts that they give to healthcare providers.
That law specifies that the Attorney General shall make all the disclosures, all the disclosed data, publicly available and searchable through an internet website. And the two others that I came up with, one had to do with unsafe children's products, the other had to do with unsafe chemicals in children's products, and that information is posted by the Department of Health. So the manufacturers disclose the information to the Department of Health, they put it on a website. So those are just
like
sitting there,
for
three,
you
know. Yeah, okay, I think, right.
Well, I like this language. I think it's pretty ironclad.
Can I just follow up on that, what she was just saying?
Yeah, please.
In terms of regulatory, so the Department of Health. Yeah, I guess they are regulatory.
That's a right, yeah.
Right, yep. Sorry.
Robert?
My question is going to the bottom of page 7 and the top of page 8, where we talk about net neutrality compliance. And
sorry, bottom of page 7.
So line 19 does not engage in any of the following practices.
Okay.
And the first one's blocking. A is blocking,
yeah.
B is throttling, and C is paid prioritization. But that has an exemption in it.
Yep.
And I'm wondering if that is how that intersects with the new waiver language, or if it's necessary.
There may be some overlap, but this waiver is specific only to paid prioritization.
And do you know why we had that
single
waiver? Out?
This is consistent with the 2015 order, the open internet order. The FCC has a similar waiver provision, and I believe, it's been a while since I've looked at the order and some of the background information. I think their concern here had to do with public safety, emergency systems. So for example, FirstNet is gonna have prioritization of calls. And to the extent that there were other areas, whether it's healthcare, that this is just one narrow waiver provision. The other waiver provision that we looked at, which is much broader in that you might not have to get certification at all, I think was intended to address a situation where there isn't a provider in your area that's net neutral compliant and critical government services are at risk.
Where's that?
And that's the one that we just went through this.
Okay.
Right?
So does the language jive okay?
I think so.
I'm just still trying to figure out how that paid prioritization, right? That one. Two P's overlays the waiver or and vice versa.
I wouldn't contradict this.
Because they're not the same.
No.
They're not the same. So the paid prioritization, it's similar to an extent, but it's only a waiver for paid prioritization and only if the ISP demonstrates that the practice would provide some significant public interest benefit and would not harm the open nature of the internet in Vermont. Under the other provision, the government may be looking for a contract in a particular municipality and there may only be one provider, and that provider does not want to be net neutral, compliant.
Going back to the pay prioritization waiver.
Yes.
So, I get the FirstNet or emergency communications, which it seems would not be a paid prioritization waiver, but an emergency public safety waiver. I'm worried about creep here.
Well, there's always a check that it's the secretary has to make the finding, but I think for FirstNet it is a paid prioritization. I think the subscribers pay a fee. I believe it's a nominal fee. And you do get, your calls will take priority over other calls. That's my understanding. So it falls within the definition of paid prioritization, but it's for a public purpose. It's not for pecuniary.
But would that same prioritization extend to emergency personnel on a different carrier?
It would be any carrier that provides a service. FirstNet is just happens to be the one that I'm familiar
right.
with. So could any other provider?
Can you help me walk
yeah.
me through that?
Sure.
So the FirstNet system is operated by AT&T, and so for FirstNet, would all emergency responders, if their contract is not with AT&T but with Verizon and there's poor interoperability, is that paid prioritization from Verizon customers, or is that just emergency public safety prioritization?
I'm not sure I understand your question. I think it's both. So any first responder that has a service and they want prioritization of that service, they could get a waiver. The company that provides the service could say, look, we are prioritizing, and we're prioritizing for these subscribers for this purpose. Is that okay? And the secretary could say, in that instance, that serves a public interest benefit, and it does not harm the open nature of the internet.
I guess the heart of my question is about if the purpose of FirstNet is and I don't want to get hung up on FirstNet, but if the purpose of FirstNet is to enable emergency responder communications, then there shouldn't be any paid prioritization involved in that. It should be emergency communications are prioritized.
You can double check, but I think the service that they provide is a paid service. That's my understanding. We have to double check that, but I believe that first responders pay for the service. It might be a nominal amount,
yeah.
a dollar
right.
or some, a month. I know that was an issue that they wanted to attract as much business, and in fact they have to have a certain number of subscribers within a certain period of time. But it's a paid service. And if it's not a paid service, then it's not prohibited. So you don't need a waiver. You just do it. So this captures that instance
yes.
where it is a paid service, making sure that's going to be exempt. If it isn't a paid service,
it is a paid service.
Yes, I believe it is a paid service. You pay a subscription fee to a retail subscription fee to have the service.
Do you remember the testimony, Robin? That's how they're going to drive competition between. That's the real
right.
trying.
Right. 99 cents or. Okay, so in the larger question, this is different than the waiver.
The other waiver is a more general, for a state contract, you don't have to be net neutral. That's conceivable under this provision, if under the Senator Brock language, you know, in these very limited circumstances. move on for now, just to look at the other.
What is our goal? Just to go through the changes?
Yes.
And we're not voting.
Does the committee want, do they feel prepared to vote on it?
The chair would like to wait until he's here to vote.
Yeah.
So the only changes with respect to the Universal Service Fund awards, you remember the language last week was disbursements, I think, and the suggestion Representative Sedilia made was to clarify that these are awards. Mm-hmm. So that's the only change there. Subsection shall apply to all awards made on or after July 1st, 2018. And this is just highlighted this because I think you wanted to add on the language that was in H 581, which passed the House and is now in Senate Finance. You're taking it up again on this Thursday. And I think you requested that provision, which is just for under the connectivity initiative specification that the money is only for capital improvements, not for operating expenses. So that's the same as what was in H581. And then I think the other request was to add a severability provision to this bill.
So we put 581 into this?
So this now has 581.
Everything?
Not 582, 581, yeah.
Right, everything in 581.
Yeah. Yep, it's just that language you see on page 20, lines 2 through 4, with respect to connectivity initiative grants.
That's all 581 had?
Yep, 582 was the increase, 0.5% increase.
Mike?
Yeah, so if the Senate does pass 581, as we sent it over, what happens to the language here?
It's worked out in the end.
Yeah, we'll reconcile it all in the end. But right now they're perfectly consistent, so.
But if there's some redundancy, word for word, one of them is dropped by these guys. So anything else?
Just making sure. It's been a while since I actually looked at this language. I'm sure we didn't skip over something. I don't think so.
So the two open issues for me now are the administration's position on Senator Brock's amendment, what their position is on that, and then the piece with the grants. So I would like that out.
That out.
Well, I'll object to that.
As would I.
You guys want it in?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'd like to say that I think the waiver, for what it's worth, I think it's really good language. I think it allows for waivers, but it spells out that it's, you know, not to be easily done, you know?
I'll get back to you with a affirmative answer on that.
Did you write that, Maria?
I wrote it with Senator Brock.
Yeah, very good.
Yay!
And in that waiver?
That's just my opinion.
He
was impressed with,
he
I
did
think,
all
pretty
the
ironclad.
The approval by the emergency board is so, there's another set of eyes and it can happen year round.
It's just a number of checks on it.
You get the clerk.
Yes, it would be the emergency board comprised of the governor and I believe the four money chairs.
So it has to be, there's only a waiver if it's pretty clear it needs to happen.
I'm good with the waiver.
Yes?
And Clay had suggested hearing maybe from small phone companies.
Not on the waiver, though.
No. This was on the grant eligibility.
And high cost, yeah.
That would be the, there's an association of the ILECs, right?
TAV, yeah.
Yeah.
Telephone Association of Vermont. Yeah.
So I'd like to hear from them regarding the grant eligibility.
All right, Mike. So it looks like we have nothing scheduled the rest of the week, right?
We have one testimony tomorrow with Barb Neal an update from the E911 board. Otherwise, our week is fluid until Friday afternoon on our site visit.
We have a Thursday, right?
Right.
No, we have a Thursday at 10:30, right?
With the Quebec.
CBU?
Yes, correct. If that is correct, that's right.
No, Quebec is Wednesday.
When's the site visit? Is it here on Monday?
Quebec is tomorrow.
It's to Department of...
that's right. Right.
So.
It's across the street.
The Quebec folks are coming tomorrow, right? We're supposed to meet with them.
But I'm trying to...
It is this week, but I don't know what day it is.
Back to your Wednesday.
I have a meeting all with Gary's.
I don't know anything about it.
Yeah, I think it's a joint thing with natural resources.
What's Thursday?
Downstairs.
We have some students coming in.
It's tomorrow, but I didn't make the time.
You know, there are
climate people
change,
from Quebec joint
administration they're going to have on Thursday.
There's a lot of
news to me.
Okay.
And just see, because I'm sitting here and I just looked it up, the waiver provision.
We have some students.
There was a roll call.
7:46.
On the Brock thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got it right here. There was the roll call. It was disagreed to the roll call. On the bill itself.
On the bill itself. So the bill
five negatives.
Yeah, 23-5. So.
Right. But that's the bill.
On the bill.
Yeah.
No,
so
you're
on
right.
His amendment, there's a divorce vote.
Disagreed to.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to talk to him.
But the disagrees were Brock, Benning, Collimore, Laurie, I think.
Pretty much the caucus.
Yeah.
All right, so when do you think we could...
Maybe Richie.
You want to meet? You want to try to get these people? Clay, when could you give us testimony on the waiver, you think, tomorrow?
Sure.
And then we, Robin, who do you want to hear?
It's the particular. What's the?
Telephone Association.
So,
Jamie.
A question for Clay.
Yeah, okay. Roger, so Jamie is the lobbyist. Roger Nishi is the...
So they have somebody here to help.
Yeah.
Yep. So what do you think tomorrow morning? Usually about 9:00.
Mm-hmm.
Try to get some things.
Yeah.
Because I know Corey would like to get. Speaking for him, but I don't know about the chairman. Okay, Mike. we'll meet at 9:00 tomorrow.
Sounds good.
Okay, Mike had a question for Clay.
Clay. The larger providers, Comcast, Verizon, AT&T, how much have they taken advantage of the USF funds for under contract?
Comcast has. So we've awarded grants in the past to Comcast. Both Comcast and Charter have made proposals. Frankly, I'd like to see that continue. AT&T. AT&T Mobility and Verizon Wireless have traditionally not taken funding through the USF.
And any other?
Can we represent the Comcast or no? What is
I'm not sure.
What have they stated a position?
Comcast
on
is McGrasson.
I imagine. Chuck Sparrow's AT&T, Nick Crasson's Comcast, and Leo9 again is for NECTA, which is the cable association. If I had to hazard a guess, I would say that they are in opposition to this bill. They're in opposition to this bill.
Let me take the guess away.
So, Robin, have you told Mike just which person or which company?
So, before Maria leaves, too.
Okay, let me just get the schedule.
Yeah.
Yeah. So who's the Jamie? Jamie who? Is the
Behan.
He represents the small ones.
Independence.
Okay.